is my absolute pleasure to introduce our last moderator, Babette Strauss, one of those pioneering women in ID and ID education that has been an incredible force in the organizations that she has worked for over the years, and an amazing advocate for our young students here, and quite frankly, one of my best personal mentors for me in my career. So I'm very grateful for having Babette be here today. She is the senior strategist and principal of Smith Strauss Consulting and is one of our Art Center faculty members, where she teaches the business of design, design professional development courses. She co-teaches our product design senior studio and is lead instructor for INSEAD MBA program in France and Singapore. Babette's career represents that critical intersection of business and design. Babette began her career in industrial design at DreamWorks and Hauser Design back in the day when I think you were the only woman, maybe? DreamWorks? Did I say DreamWorks? Sorry. And I believe you. The only woman. That's our maverick. Where she held design director, management, and operation positions. She then was part of a small core team that built an internal global design organization for Nokia from the ground up and served as the global director of operations for over a decade. 10 years ago, Babette left for Nike to serve as the Global Footwear Design Director of Operations. Prior to starting her own consulting business, Babette was the Senior Design Director of Design Strategy and Design Operations Specialist at Intersection in San Diego, designing and facilitating workshops that helped their clients address tough challenges or capture opportunities to improve critical business results. I can't think of anybody more appropriate to lead this discussion. Babette, all yours.
Thank you.
Longer the older you get. Yeah, I've twitched through a lot of this, these presentations, because I've lived a lot of these stories, and we know we've got some marks to show, but I've had wonderful support from amazing people, and it's really my privilege to work with many of the students, and it was a very inspiring presentation. Thank you for all of those, and to all of you other leaders who have presented. We've seen the embodiment of real leadership. We've seen the embodiment of leadership in so many of the people that have been up here today, and they've skirted around lots of issues, or it hit them head on. And our panel specifically, we've tried to raise the issues around leadership head on today. Oddly enough, and I like to do my own bit of research, and I was doing a little research going into this, and I came across an amazing posting. There's a leadership today. A leadership shortage is one of the biggest barriers to growth at companies around the world. In fact, developing new leaders is the number one talent challenge facing organizations worldwide, with 86% of companies rating it as urgent or highly important. And now, the other figures which I researched, I didn't capture them for this, is that the number of women decreases as the leadership positions go up in the organizations. And so the opportunities are really here for all of us, both men and women, but today we're focusing on the opportunities in many ways for women. What I'd like to do is introduce those on the panel that haven't been introduced yet. And I'll start here with Ginny, very briefly, senior manager at the Hot Wheels packaging, in Hot Wheels packaging design at Mattel. And you've been there for, what, 5 years? 5 years, so a good long stint there. And she's had previous positions with Disney, at Lego, Airstream, and she's also worn a lot of different hats, including marketing, I think, right? So, welcome to the panel. I'm going to try to say this correctly. Mariana Prieto?
Perfect.
Okay. And Mariana, Sara's already been introduced, but I'm not forgetting her. So, Mariana has a really deep background in social innovation. She brings a lot of insights in this area today. You're currently an independent consultant, but you've been part of the internal team as well. She's had positions with and co-founder of Blue Barrel Concepts. She's been a Design Innovation Week, and she's worked with IDEO Org. So, bringing those to us today. And Marnie Gerber, who I've known actually since she was an intern at DesignWorks when I was there, and she was a colleague and a personal, and is a personal friend. Senior Design Director at Nike. She's been there many, many years, and she's a tour de force. She was a designer at Mattel, and she also has experience as a freelancer, so she can add some depth of what we're talking about here. A fact I'd like to share is all of our participants today are married, and two of the four have two children each, and three have designer partners or husbands, and one's partner is in a connected field. So it's an interesting set of data here. We'll use data. Okay. So thought that might be interesting because one of the things I understand for a lot of you new designers or about to be minted designers, you're always wondering how to juggle the world of business and your personal life. So we hope to hit on some of these things. But what I'd like to do is help the audience get to know all of you a little bit better and this topic of leadership. So the first question, which for everybody I think, is really how would you characterize your personal leadership brand? You know, what do you think it, how would you describe yourself or how do others describe your strengths as leaders? And I'll just open it up.
I would say that my personal brand and my leadership style has definitely developed over my years as a leader. It's now, I would say, that my leadership style is people first. So I always remind my team that, yes, we are making products, we're making packaging, whatever we're making, like the last speakers have talked about, it's not about that actual object that you're making, it's about the people that you interface with along the journey, and that actually affects the end result of what you are designing, but it also affects your entire career as a designer. So people first is the way that I choose to lead, and I remind my team it's we're a family, and that's how we get things done.
I have also become known for that people thing. I bring in a lot of talent. I hire lots of young talent and create very diverse teams, and not only gender, but where you're from, what your level is. So having really a very diverse team and then training those young designers and older designers either to become a design director or to go out into the company of Nike and have different jobs, and what does each person need, and kind of really being more attentive to each person's path and desire for their career.
For me, since I work as an independent contractor, I'm constantly hiring new people to come in for specific projects, whether it's for 12 weeks or whether it's for a longer project. But the main success for me is having hired people that are better at my job than I am and delegating all of that work so that I can oversee it and always be three steps ahead in where the overall project is going and making sure that they have the resources they need in order to do the job best. And many times that is about communication with the rest of the organization about what our team is doing. Because I'm currently working in humanitarian aid, it is a old dinosaur that has wonderful things about it, but it doesn't have this innovation in its DNA quite yet. The team that we're building is quite new. And so collaborating with them and explaining to them what our team's doing is critical to the success of the overall project.
Great, thanks. What you hear often is hire people smarter than you. And it's been something that's at least served me well, and it's gotten me out of work I didn't want to do anyway. So it's really a good plan. It's working. So let's go back a little ways to your Art Center days when you were here. So think back, and Mario, when did you first consciously realize that you wanted to be a leader?
I don't think I had one moment where I woke up and was like, oh, this is going to be me. But Art Center was extremely formative because Art Center never really gave me the chance to think about it and question it. I started, and from day one, I always had a team behind me that saw that that's what I wanted, even before I had noticed that I wanted it. I do remember little moments, though, like, for example, third term review. I was panicked about third term. And I showed up towards the end of it. Norm Sherman, he grabbed the paper that he was writing those notes, and then he wrote really big TA for the spring. And then underneath it, underlined leadership. And I hadn't even thought about it. It was just a cue of, okay, this is the path that I need to keep going on. And Art Center was always so supportive in that towards the end of my Art Center career, time here, I took the leadership role to build the new TEDx here at school, which I've been really happy to see that it's been replicated once and then it's gonna happen again this year. But again, that was all Art Center supporting me and sort of guiding me.
Fantastic. And what was Mustard? Can you tell us a little bit about Mustard?
Sure. Mustard was a social innovation group that had been already built by William Tang. And when he left, I took over it, which was a way to bring social innovation into design. When I first started this idea, social innovation was really a career that didn't quite exist. It was very difficult to figure out what was your way forward in it. There was really no clear path. The pioneers were few and far in between, and there was a lot of figuring out to do. And so Mustard was a way to bring students to have these conversations and find shared leaders and mentors.
Sounds like a great, great opportunity for people. How about you, Jenny? Any thoughts on that?
Good question.
When did you first consciously realize that you wanted to become a leader, or what activities during your time at Art Center do you think helped you strengthen or get you started in this path?
Yeah, I think when we were talking about this earlier, the idea of leadership to me is so much less about the number of people that are behind you. It's more about ideas that are just unique to you, and that other people say, hey, I have that same idea, I want to join you. So I think at Art Center, kind of like Mariana was saying, like, it wasn't so much I'm going to start all these groups or I'm going to start this new movement or anything like that. It was the teaching and the training of you, what makes you uniquely you, and how can you be really bold about that. That is what all along at Art Center I was being taught, and then in that process, when I stepped out of Art Center, it was really natural because learning to take what makes me and just boldly go into the workforce with it is what caused me to start thinking, well, everyone is doing something this way, but I think that it actually needs to be redesigned this way, whether or not it's like people and like org charts, or it actually is a product. And then that has progressed over the years in my career because I think fresh out of school, it was kind of like, don't we all do this? Don't we all, like, you know, at Art Center, don't you all just say, this is my unique perspective and I'm gonna forge ahead. And then you step out into your career and you realize that a lot of people are really beholden to what everyone thinks around them and is kind of waiting for permission. And so it takes a few years, at least for me, it took a few years to sort of realize that yes, that is what is going to be the culture that I am gonna experience in my career, but how am I gonna set myself apart from that? So I think over the years in my career, I've been able to stretch my wings and really like define how I'm gonna take what's uniquely me and build a movement around it. But it's kind of like it swells in your time at Art Center and you say, yeah, I can do anything. And then you get out and you realize, wait a second, no one's doing this. And then you figure it out. So.
Sarah, any thoughts on this?
Yeah, you know, going back to the last question for a minute, you know, when I read 360 feedback from the teams I've led over the last 20 years, the constant that I hear is authenticity as a big part of my style, and has a lot to do with my upbringing. I grew up in the country, I did a lot of chores, I have a big work ethic. You know, authentically, you're always gonna hear what I am thinking. I don't pull a lot of punches, but I am just fascinated by people. And what really drives my leadership style is understanding the people that I'm working with and drawing out their potential and helping the people that I lead achieve things that they themselves didn't think they could achieve. That is like the most satisfying thing when someone says, gosh, I can't believe that you chose me to lead that project. I was really scared. I didn't think I could do it, but you were behind me all the way and I did it, you know? So I think that empowerment is a really key piece of leadership.
It's a lot like the satisfaction you get out of teaching all these amazing students.
Absolutely.
And having them come back year after year doing fantastic things. So I applaud you all for that, and thank you. Marty, I have a specific question because you mentioned to me that you had some reservations about pursuing a leadership path. So could you reflect a little bit on that transition, and maybe how do you get your creative satisfaction in your role now?
All right, yes, I did not want to be a leader. I loved designing, and I think part of it started, like I was telling Babette, that early on, I worked at Mattel, and then I worked at Avia, another footwear company, and I had some maybe not so great bosses, and some of them were women, and it didn't really matter that they were women, but I just thought, I don't want to be that boss that everybody hates, so I just want to design stuff, and I love that. And I was at Nike for few years, and people were encouraging me to be a leader, and I just kept putting my hand up like this. No, I just wanted to design. And so anyways, I went to this next step class that they offered, and there were three leaders, and they taught the class, and it was 3 days, and this woman, Pat Zedek, was very influential to me, because as she was leading and teaching the class, I just saw how collaborative she was as a leader, and how human she was, and how she helped other people with their careers, and I just hadn't experienced that. And so I thought, if I could be a leader like that, I'll do this. So pretty soon I became a director, and learned that I love it, and I love helping these younger designers with their careers, and then creatively, you know, that was the other fear, is not designing anymore, and I was afraid of that. And because when you design when you're a designer, you stand for that thing that you're designing, and what are you going to be judged on? So it took me a while too to feel comfortable not designing the thing anymore. But quickly learned it's the team, and how everybody on the team has different skills, and what are all of our strengths. And as a team, we use that together, and then you just, you know, you kick ass because you're really good as a team. And even like some of the product up on the screen that I flashed, it's not all my product. And it's, I think it's also this we culture, not me culture, that I try to have every day.
Thank you for that. Unfortunately, there's not a lot of time to ask the same question, so we're going to go a little broader in our scope. Ginny, we were talking about, we all had conversations before this, so we've covered a lot of material previously, but we were talking about the importance of networks, and of course you heard from Marty the impact that a single mentor or role model had on her entire career. So Ginny, you described yourself as a connector to me. Can you tell us what that's meant for you in your life, and how that's helped you path?
Yeah. I find that constantly, and I'm sure many people as designers are like this, most of us are like this, is we're thinking of pulling inspiration and pulling ideas from everywhere. It's not like we say, now I need to be inspired, I'm gonna go, you know, surf the internet or whatever, I'm gonna have a Pinterest account. It's like we're inspired by everything. So in light of that, the idea of, man, I'm working on this project, these people at another company that I knew from back at Art Center, or I knew from another job I had, they're working on something similar, but I'm inspired by that. Or this person is really good at X, Y, and Z, and this person actually has the need to be inspired by that same person. So sometimes we stay so much in our silos that we miss a lot of information as well as inspiration. And so I think that has actually been a huge part of my journey as a creative leader, because now of course
course, you have to watch out for like IP and all that, but I find that I'm like, well, I don't care if you work for another company, or I don't care if you are in another department, even though it's like literally like two doors down. We still need to connect, right? So taking that idea and saying, okay, well, I'm gonna start something that may seem weird and may seem uncomfortable for people, but let's just go ahead and have these round tables. So at my company, it's a bit of a joke because I'll constantly be working with our leaders, even like the C-suite team, and just say, I have this idea. And the idea usually starts with like connecting this group to this group, or connecting people from outside the company to bring them in and do like speaker series, or just doing these roundtable discussions, and then quantifying what we're going to get out of it. So a lot of my like passion projects, like side projects, end up being along those lines, and they're incredibly rewarding to me, but also they are very helpful to my team, because then we can draw on that information and move forward with actual like business justified solutions.
Thanks for that. Summer, I have two questions for you. Number one, where should our young designers look for role models and mentors? And maybe if we have time, you could talk about this comment you made to me, depositing something in exchange for being mentored. What is it that we as the mentees can give back to the mentor to make this a quid pro quo kind of arrangement?
That's a great question. You know, when I was younger as a designer, I did work really actively on networking, and I encourage everyone in this room, if you haven't already started this, start now. Your network really is one of the most important things you build in your career. And what I find, you know, when I was younger, I would try to produce a point of view, read, research, come up with a point of view that would be valuable to someone in a higher position or someone in an adjacent position in a company that may not see things the way a designer sees things, may not see their customer the way I see their customer. And I would just proactively offer my point of view to the people that I wanted time from. And it's incredible how generous people are. There's almost a human, you know, reaction to being given something that requires you to give something back. So I'd say, you know, don't be timid about that. I reached out to just huge legends when I was just coming out of grad before I even came to Art Center. I reached out to Milton Glaser and got an internship at his studio. And then shortly after that, I asked to be paid. it was interesting to see that really there's such generosity in the design community, and especially I think I see that in myself, you know, not that I'm promoting myself that way, but I want to help young designers. I'm driven to help young designers, and I think you'd be surprised how many mentors out there are. I also look for business leaders because of the environment that I work in, and my background is more in design, so I was working in this last 20 years and just this fusion of technology and business and design, and picked a few people that had MBAs or more of a left-brain approach to try to not assimilate their thinking, but become more familiar with and more able to predict what someone like that might be bringing my way. So yeah, I think it's important to go ahead and just, you know, what's the worst thing they're gonna do, say no.
Okay, thanks. We're going to shift gears a little bit to maybe a topic some of you want to know about. Relationships, spouses, partners, for a couple of minutes. Each of our guests today, our panelists today, is married. And so the question is, I'm going to start with Mariana. Mariana's husband, Danny, was a co-worker of hers at IDEO. And now they're not working together in the same place. But you talked about how you managed to keep design from taking over your private lives, as well as talking about how he's helped you with your career. You have some unique perspectives on managing the separation. Would you be willing to share?
So we weren't just coworkers. We were actually on the same project, on the same team, and he was my project lead. So we started with that. Very early on in our IDEO career, we'd only met maybe 6 months before, and we went on a 5-week trip to India. And that's when I knew either this is going to be fantastic or it's going to be a horrible trip, but it'll be the end of the relationship. And then once we got back and we started living together, we realized that because we were on the same projects, it was really easy for projects to creep into our daily lives all the time. And so we came up with a set of rules that actually worked a lot better than I thought they would. But our rules were, first in the morning, we cannot talk about work until we are at the IDEO door. And on the way out, we can only talk about work after the door, but at the subway entrance, so that we had a little bit of a walk, like, when we talk about whatever we needed to get out. And there were moments where, I remember one time we were standing in the rain outside of the subway stop because we just really wanted to keep talking about this, but we didn't want to break our room. And then later, once we left IDEO, we moved down to Columbia and we're both working freelance. So we weren't working on the same projects, but we were still both working from home, which has another set of challenges. And so we built one of the bedrooms as an office. And the rule then was we were only allowed to talk about work in that room. And so if we were in the kitchen and I had a question, I would tell him, like, do you mind if we go in there for like 15 minutes? No more. And we talk about it and then we walk off. And now we both have different jobs and different offices, and so it's a little bit more fluid, but we still remain a little bit cut off and talking about work on the weekends.
I find that very inspiring because I was also married to a full-time designer, and it just crept into every part of our lives. It wasn't always good. We had some pretty good knockdown dragouts. So. And happily married even after those, so that was okay. We're going to keep moving through some of these topics so we don't skip over any important topics. But Marnie, you had a great recommendation about how to manage time. It was a nice pearl of wisdom.
So actually, I learned this from my
corporate coach. Just turned on. And she taught me to start living my life at Nike. Like during work hours, she said you should do have your life split up into thirds. One third should be your job, and that's what you spend time on doing your job. One third networking, and then one third taking care of yourself, whether that's working out or eating right and having lunch. A lot of people skip lunch. I don't do that. But I have to say, I don't think I've ever really achieved that one third, one third, one third, but I think it's really a great goal. It's a really good goal. But I do try, and I think about it a lot.
Great. Well, thanks for that.
Yeah.
Mariana, you mentioned something. We're going to jump into job searches for a second because these women have amazing things to share. But Mariana, you talked about the differences between men and women in applying for jobs, and you had some insights on that topic.
Well, actually, Katie touched on this for a second, and it's, for me, it started because one of my mentors mentioned that the best jobs that she'd ever had were the jobs that she felt underqualified for. And it really resonated with me, and then we started talking about this article that I think Katie was referring to, where women see a description of job requirements as a base, as a starting point, as a checklist, do I have all this stuff? Whereas many men see it as a wish list. And it really resonated with me because my first real, should I say, win as a job was a year after Art Center. I was still finding a way to get into social innovation, and like I mentioned before, it was complicated because there were very few people that were doing this as a full-time job and not as a side job or volunteer work. And so I really wanted to go to IDEO.org and be a fellow there. And I saw the job requirements, and I fit most of them except 5 years of professional work experience. I was pretty far from that. But you know what, I decided to apply anyway, and I thought, well, I already have a no, I don't apply, so that's why I won't do it. And I applied, I worked on this portfolio for a month, and then I forgot about it. Forgot about it so much that I got a puppy. Which is a terrible idea for a job that will take you job 70% of the year. And they called me back, and I remember on my third interview, maybe I was sitting in front of Jocelyn Wyatt and Patrice Martin, the two co-founders of IDEO.org, and they told me, they said, you don't fit the requirements that we asked for, so why should we hire you? And I told them two things. One was that I graduated from Art Center and they had a Design Matters program, which meant that I had been working with real clients and had real research
really introduce one-on-one experience that had prepared me for that. So that gave me another year, maybe. And then I just told him very sincerely, because I can do this job and I can do it well, and I know that I can grow into whatever I'm missing. And I left thinking, they might never call me back, but
and they did. Wonderful. Yeah. Wonderful. Good success story. All of you are encouraged to be bold. Ginny, in this same vein of jobs, you talked about interviewing bosses for a fit. Can you talk to me? Tell us, how do you do that? What do you look for?
Well, along those lines, I always tell anyone, if they are interested in a different career path or even just a different company, to take any interview you get, because you're getting information from that interview and you're also just getting practice and you're networking, right? So there has been interviews that I've left and I thought, like, 2 minutes into it, I thought, I don't want this job. And they may be thinking the same thing, I don't know, but this is just gonna be an awesome conversation and a free lunch or whatever, you know? And so out of that, though, is the idea that when you're strategically making a change in your career, it's your choice, obviously, unless you get fired and then you need to find another job. But for the most part, for me, I've been blessed with the fact that, like, I'm interviewing each and every time with another job that, like, and I start most of the conversations with, by the way, I am happily employed, I'm just always interested in what could challenge me more, right? So that's also very appealing to an employer, because they think, well, you're not desperate, and this is like a very smart decision that they're making in this process. But as I speak with that hiring manager or the other people that I may be working with, I'm doing my due diligence because I know myself better than they know me. And so I'm doing my due diligence to think, well, first of all, am I gonna be happy in this job? Because it's not gonna do them any good if I'm not happy in this job. And what can I bring to the table here? And so knowing more about those particular people that I'm gonna work with every day informs me as to, well, how are they gonna shape and change my career? Because I'm rubbing shoulders with them consistently, and I'm going to be forced to a certain degree to perform along the lines of their leadership. And then also, you know, what can I bring to the table to change them? And I have been in certain situations where I look and I'm like, that has the writing on the wall of an entire environment that I've been in before. And it was a great fit then, but I don't think at this point in my career I can bring the same thing to that particular team. So, and 9 times out of 10, it was like a mutual decision. But there has been times when, in interviewing that boss, I can think of one specific time, in sort of interviewing that boss, they came back to me in sort of like a very antagonistic way for not taking the job, and that sealed the deal for me. I'm like, I don't want any part of this. But it was helpful to have done that beforehand, and then when they came back antagonistic, I was like, okay, but I interviewed them.
Thank you for that. We are almost out of time, so we're gonna have to jump to the last, what I'd asked each of these ladies to provide us with are some pearls of wisdom. If you take away anything from this conversation, what would the top pointers be? But before we jump to that, please engage them in conversation. They've got techniques for working with men and women in their teams. We pose the question of older men on teams, how women in our positions work with older men, older women. Really great conversation, so I encourage you to have those conversations. But Mariana shared something with me, and I just want to quickly go over it, is that she was telling me the story that she goes out into other cultures and didn't do a traditional wedding band at first, and shared with me that she had to ask her husband at some point for a physical wedding band. Could you just briefly tell us, because we've got to conclude, but why that was important?
Sure. So in general in my career, I haven't really felt negative or positive impact about being a woman. I don't consider myself a woman. I mean, I do, I'm aware. but it's never come up until I'm in the field. And that's sometimes good when I'm doing a project when it's talking to 13-year-old girls about sex. Sometimes it's bad when it's a culture where it's seen as a negative thing for a woman to look a man in his eyes, and I'm trying to do a one-to-one interview. And I'm Latin, so I'm also very and that's, it doesn't come off the right way. So for a long time I was doing this research, and many times I would have people just saying inappropriate things to me, and if I wanted to have a drink with a colleague, sometimes I was afraid that it would be misunderstood. And so after a year of being married, Danny and I had gotten wedding tattoos instead. And I asked him for a wedding ring because I thought that it would be helpful in sending a social cue that I'm not interested and this is not why I'm here.
And did you notice any changes?
Significantly, yes.
Very important. Well, I think if...
Do we have time for...
Oh, yeah.
Okay. So who would like to go first? The two or three key takeaways that you would like these folks to remember from today, advice around a leadership path.
One thing I think about mentors and having mentors, I think that's always this like, what's a mentor? How do I get one? And one thing that I have learned over the years and always share with the designers in my group and people I talk to is have many mentors because you don't have to have just one, and it could be a burden for one person to always be everybody's mentor. So whatever the problem that you're trying to solve, like, go find amazing people that, like at Nike, there's just so many smart people that depends on what I need to solve or that I go to that person. And I think I love the be bold because just going for what you want, asking that most important person or that going to the company you dream of being at, like ideo.org, like just doing it because what can help? What can happen if you don't? So just be bold and do what you love.
Just do it.
Just do it. And, oh, I wanted to say, do more of what you love too. And that's something I've learned over the years is, you know, at first you don't know what your strengths are maybe, but you learn them over the years. And then like, I don't like that, don't do that anymore. I like more of this, don't do more of this. And so I think that's a really important one that as I'm getting older, I'm really getting to know what I really love to do. So
thank you for that. Mariana.
Slightly building on this, but I've learned that you're never too young and you're never too old to be a mentor or a mentee. Mm-hmm. There's always somebody on either side that you can learn from, which adds on just always being humble and understanding that there's a lot to learn from everybody around you. There's no reason why you need to do this alone. And even when you're helping somebody else come on, you end up learning a ton from them. So that's one. And the other is, it's generally just do it. I do want to highlight the importance of this. I have a lot of people ask me, what is the best way to get into social innovation and how should I build my portfolio? Should I try this internship or should I maybe build the skills so I can prove that I can do it? Honestly, just do it. Whatever it is that you feel is the direction of what you want to do, once you take the first step, the second will follow.
And that was a result of a serendipitous moment that you had with Emily Pilligan, correct?
Did. I was an intern at Design Matters, taking photocopies and putting up posters. Emily Pilligan came, and I caught her by the coffee carts, who, just in case you don't know, Emily Pilligan started one of the first social innovation enterprises, and she was a pioneer in this. And I was so excited, I went up to her and asked her, what can I do to get into social innovation? And she turned around and she was like, just do it. It was so obnoxious, but also the perfect answer.
You never know what you're gonna hear from anyone in this room. So, Sarah.
Well, I just want to suggest that there's a lot of value to integrating what you do at work and what you do at home. And while I agree it's good to separate the relationship part a bit, it's funny, my husband now works at Facebook and I work at Google, so we don't talk about work. But I'm going to write a book or a blog about how I've been applying agile development processes at home. I'll quickly give you a few examples. I mean, I'm a very busy person. My husband's very busy, and I don't have time to cajole and remind and nag my twins. So ever since they were about 8 years old, we've had a Kanban board in our hallway, and they move their commits to done. It's fantastic to teach that kind of self-reliance and to use something that works really well in a workplace at home. You know, similarly, the last role that I took was so different than the roles I had been in before that I actually asked a friend who was in Europe to use her apartment for a week, and I ran a design sprint on my career. And I just filled up a huge board with why I wanted this job, why I was right for this job, and basically formulated a presentation that removed any obstacle to hiring me for that job. So putting the amount of energy that you put into work into yourself and using the methods that are really rigorous to do that is a really important thing to think about.
My three takeaways, and this is very personal towards me too. So there's the aspect of grit that we talk about. When that comes to me personally, there's the part of it that has patience in it that is my Achilles heel. So for me, it's easy to say, like, I'm just gonna go out there and I'm just gonna be a crazy woman. I'm just gonna get this done. Well, that's like just a crazy woman. So the aspect of it that's patience is, well, I'm gonna pursue this and I'm gonna be strategically disruptive. And I'm going to keep beating that same drum, even though everyone is not listening, until I find a way to make this happen. And so that level of patience is something that I'm constantly reminding myself of. And then the other thing would be just to be a lifelong learner. It's easy sometimes. What I love about all this entire event is that as you listen to the backgrounds of so many people, we're reinventing ourselves continually just to either stay relevant or just because we're curious as designers. And so being a lifelong learner is painful, but the reward is huge. And then my third thing was just the listening. And we keep talking about listening. And we talk about listening to our partners, like our counterparts, engineers, or whatever. But the idea of listening to me is that as designers, we've learned and we're constantly grooming ourselves on how to see things, right? To see things in the right way. But in terms of listening, I'm not only listening to that person that I know I need to get approval from to get this project through, I'm listening to my team because they are way smarter than me, and also I'm listening to myself, my intuition, which is what I loved about your talk too. So coupling those three together makes this like special sauce of creative leadership.
Thank you for that. Really some great ideas that you can take away. Going forward, do we have time for some Q&A? Are we going to do a couple of questions?
Okay. I just have a realistically, what is your work week like? Are you spending in 40, 60, 80 hours a week?
All of the above.
All the
seriously.
Because I know you talk about like personal life work balance, but the reality is as designers, we're so into what we do and we love what we do and we don't have limits. So how do we sort of gauge that sort of that balance and be realistic with it, knowing timelines, deadlines, production, schedule, manufacturing, everything that comes with it?
I'd love to just say one thing about that, which is it's up and down. It's not one way. Like, it's not you're working 50-hour weeks for 2 months. It's usually up and down. And in a relationship where you're trying to establish work-life balance, it's important to put each other on notice. I'm going to be crazy for the next month. Can you cover and understand that I need your support? Making those things explicit, I think, is really helpful.
I think I may be unique in the sense that I have had several jobs where it's like 60-hour weeks or whatever. I'm really committed with my team, and of course it swells with projects. That's just needs to be understood. But I'm really committed with my teams to be an example of that, like work balance. So like if they email me over the weekend, I may see the email, but I don't respond to it because I don't want to train them that that's what they need to do either. So it takes a lot of self-control. Like it's in my company, it's a very old school company and it is a beast. And the idea of even like telecommuting or flex hours is like unheard of. And so supporting that on my team has been a huge commitment. And so it actually takes, you know, I have a 3-hour round trip commute every day. So that's part of my office as well. Well, my team knows that I'm committed to the fact that I'm gonna start my hour and a half commute and then I'm going to be taking conference calls and all that. But by the time I hit the door, yes, like design and all these ideas and strategy, those keep going. Like, you can't turn those off. But the idea of I gotta send 10 more emails or whatever, I try to preserve a balance on that just because I'm actually trying to train my team something very specific towards that, and it's different in every environment.
I would say middle on not emailing during the weekend, in the evenings,
like I said, the one-third, I really try to show that again.
Oops, like them, yeah.
So that I'm the example of what I think is healthy and balanced. And yes, there are weeks and weekends or certain deadlines that you go crazy and you work like an art center student. And then there are other weeks that you're, you know, more balanced. So it's never perfect, I would say.
Oh, I agree with all of what was said. What I would add is that, for one, we work in a creative field. And in order to be inspired and in order to do our job very well, we also need to be rested. So there are times where it's best for you to decide that this is the time for me to take this time off. For example, this year I decided that I was burnt out from field work since my first project in Guatemala was 7 years ago. I've been nonstop in the field working with Ebola and natural disasters, and I was tired. So I took a 4 month sabbatical where I just watched Netflix, and I went to museums, and I traveled, but for me, I was a volunteer at a pet rescue. So it's important to make those decisions. And the last thing I'll add is that we've also been prototyping with this with my husband, and so he runs a company from Australia in New York, and sometimes I'll be running a project in Liberia from New York, and so we work through the night. And we are prototyping a really long 4-day work week and a 3-day weekend. Which has been working really, really well. But it does depend on your job, and it does depend on different situations. Just prototype it, test it, see what works for you.
Mm-hmm. Perfect, thanks. One last question. This has sort of been a theme throughout the whole day, so I'll just ask it directly. What has been the hardest hurdle as a woman that you've come up against, and how did you overcome it? In the workplace, there's a lot of unsaid hurdles, and I'm wondering if you'll just answer that straight on.
Oh, the elephant in the room.
One thing I'll just talk about, because I did want to tell you about this at Nike, is in footwear design, it's a very, there's not that many women. So I'm just saying this because I want everybody in school, Ivy, come and be a footwear designer. We need more women. Because of that, and it took me a while to even know that or notice the problem. I had young designers coming to me saying, "Marty, there's no women in leadership in footwear design. What does that mean for me?" I'm like, "Wow, I didn't even notice. I should take notice." And I did some checking into that, and sure enough, the picture didn't look very good. But to instead of focusing on the problem, we did a lot of research, got the women together, and now we are working as about 20-person group. Every month we have a meeting, we have really inspirational speakers, and it's become a really safe place for women to come and talk about anything. And we have each other's backs, we talk about solutions. It's not a bitch fest, it's a very, very constructive group, and our senior leaders are very supportive of the idea and the group, and it's been really positive. So I think that
answers
that.
Yeah, that was very nice. Anyone else?
Yeah, I wanted to talk a little bit about, you know, it is really hard to bear witness to gender bias for me, you know, and to see that happening. And, you know, that's, I think, why Angela Lee Duckworth's work was so meaningful to me. It really got me to stop thinking about the fairness element of the balance of authority between men and women at work and how women are treated at work. Because effort doesn't know gender, and effort doesn't know, you know, it's a very essential thing to me to know that at the end of the day, I'm judged by my effort, and I really take great effort. So it helps me get past feeling that it's unfair that certain people have advantages that I don't have. And I've outperformed most anyone that I felt was in a position that wasn't fair.
There you go.
Along those lines, and I forget who was mentioning it in their talks today, but about the idea that, yes, there's the aspect that we're women and we're in, like for me, I'm in a field where it's mostly industrial design as well as transportation design, which is like a double whammy for no females in the career. So there's that aspect, but then there's also the aspect that we're designers. And so the idea of thinking differently compared to your counterparts is even stronger, right? So with those two things, I'm constantly trying to separate the idea of my need to actually either relate or get the buy-in from the individuals that may be naysayers. I'm constantly evaluating, well, is that actually effort that I need to take to move forward in my career or to help my team move forward? Or is that just something that I'm going to choose to, like, very consciously say, yeah, that's an issue that I see, and I am choosing to actually move forward with this instead. So that answer is different on every project or every person, but I'm currently working with something very, very related to that, where there's an entire team of guys that I have traveled with for the last 7 years, three times a year overseas. And we spend a lot of time together. And it has been an awesome opportunity for me as a female to figure out how I show up in every environment. Because when you're deep in traveling with the same group of guys that are that may consider themselves to be like a boy club, how do you help lead your team in a way? Like, and my team is mostly men anyways, so there's that challenge as well. But like, what I've been working on just the last 3 days with a female counterpart of mine is, how do we choose to say, this is what we want to address about that, and how do we choose to say, and this is just where we're gonna move forward, and not let it distract us.
I think that's a great point. Don't let some of these issues distract you. They will pull you into an area which is really taking a lot of your energy. It's very counterproductive, and it can quickly make you very unsatisfied with a potentially very satisfying job. So I think we here dig in, have some grit, and just do it. Keep doing it. And political intelligence, a lot of emotional intelligence, all of these things come into play as leaders, and we've seen great qualities, as I said earlier, in today's leaders. So I want to thank the panel today. It's been really a pleasure getting to know each other.